Hi, and welcome to our first video of Demystifying Digital. Demystifying Digital is a series of short videos which will help you understand the foundation concepts of digital technologies, its application across multiple industries. We will underscore the point how certain digital technologies like the Internet of Things and artificial intelligence is disrupting the world around us, creating multiple business models and avenues of engaging with our customers very differently than what we have experienced before. This is the first short video on the series which deals with the foundational concept of what is digital. Everybody is talking about digitization at a sector level and their responses as enterprises. But in all of these descriptions, there is a huge amount of divergence, and therefore the need that this was felt by me was to bring in some basic concepts on which we can talk about being digital or not being digital and not being lost amongst multiple technology applications and uses. And so here goes. Now, when I talk to my clients about digital, I get three basic response types, or what we call the archetypes. The first is the technology led, which is using the right technology in the right context to solve a particular problem which has been plagued by automation or manual usage or inefficiencies. Typically, this is seen in the manufacturing environments and around IoTization or Internet of Things applications across different equipment categories and types. So what these people basically do, they sensorize equipment, so equip different parts of their machines through sensors and emit data. So they connect multiple devices, and what they get is performance data, which is condition data, which is the way the machine is performing under multiple conditions and circumstances, put the data into the cloud and get analytics to help improve performance. While this is a very significant use case of digital, it is only an application of digital which is no regret strategy for manufacturing environments, but not digital holistically, as they say. The second phenomena is the customer journey, which is how I improve the customer journey, how I make it frictionless, how I make it single touch, multiple channel, and so on and so forth. Now, this is also again a very important use case, but however, it is a limited scope application, merely a limited scope application, like Amazon using Amazon Pay to make your journey, to make the payment process very elegant. The third, which is probably the response that I get from my alleged immature clients, is when they automate certain processes, they claim to be digital. Now, automation of a back-end claim processing of an insurance company through putting in a rules engine using technology is not digital. While all of these definitions or examples are not incorrect, but they are diverse. And being diverse, they lead into siloed application and do not create a uniform view of digital. While they might create localized or functional value, in true sense, they are not. I would argue that they are not digital. Now, so based on my understanding and my work in digitization, helping clients build digital strategies and applications, and teaching people on the subject, I consider digital as a combination of two important vectors, which is you are digital when you are either reimagining the business model or creating a fundamentally new customer experience. And again, when you're reimagining a business model, you are into two parts. One is you're developing a business in its adjacencies. And I'll give you a very simple example. I'm a runner and I use a brand of shoe called ASICS. And ASICS is an international brand. It is a very well-reputed brand. But what ASICS did is they bought out a fitness app or a run monitoring app called RunKeeper, in which they kind of all my data of running is stored, my time splits, my elevation gains, my running cadence is stored, and it's a huge amount of data that they have. With that, they have certain run challenges. What ASICS has built, it's a free premium model where at the higher end you pay in terms of you get analysis of data, how you're doing. That's at one level where you have a monthly and a yearly subscription. And the second is you can participate. There are certain training programs which are digital training programs available in the app. So what ASICS has done is repositioned itself from being a classical shoe company to a fitness and a wellness kind of an ecosystem by using an app. It is an extension of the model. Similar extensions are found in the great manufacturing companies listed above, which is creating new revenue streams, bringing out the inefficiencies of the sector. And I would like to call out these great companies, which is Caterpillar, John Deere, Hilti, Asia Brown Boveri, in being the vanguard of such applications. The second more important vector is creating a new customer experience, and it basically constitutes of four or five parts. The first one is designing the customer experience outside in, which is collecting data, looking at what customers value and designing the experience. The second is understanding how customers are interacting with the brand. As they interact with multiple channels with the brand, either digital or physical or your call center, they leave around a particular they leave around a footprint, and how we are engaging in with the customer by collecting the data is basically contextual interactivity. The third element is customer data at the heart of the consumer experience. So I collect a lot of customer data and I personalize it to deliver my goods and services differently, which is a personalized phenomenon. The final eight is the journey-focused innovation, which is meshing physical and digital experiences, which is bringing the experience of the online world with the physical touch points to create a very unique customer experience. Companies in this customer experience-led innovation are Caesars Entertainment, Starbucks, Capital One, and Gap, to name a few. There are many, but I'm just calling out a few names as examples. Now, what I'm going to do is now take you through an example of a completely different or an extension of the business model which this great company Caterpillar has been able to pull off. Now, Caterpillar, we all know, is an earth-moving behemoth, global multinational. It has clients across the customers, across the construction, marine and resource sectors. And if you go down the Mumbai Pune Highway, you'll see Caterpillar earth-moving equipment. And it's a leading brand in its industry. Now, what Caterpillar did was using telematics and sensorization, they kind of made all their equipment intelligent. As a result of which, when the equipment was purchased by their clients and went on the field performing its tasks and duties, it emitted a lot of performance data, which is the efficiency levels, predictive maintenance, at what conditions they perform best, and so on and so forth. These data was modeled using AI techniques and sold as a service to their customers. So from a customer standpoint, it not only I buy a world-class equipment, but I get insights on how to use the equipment to optimize its performance. Now, Caterpillar obviously couldn't do it alone. It created an ecosystem through an app called Cat Connect, where it uses AT&T's communication, the company's Huawei subscription management. These services were sold as subscriptions, Torque Robotics, because it actually used Cat Connect to give this insights to non-Caterpillar clients, also creating a huge competitive advantage. Microsoft Azure being its cloud provider and its fleet management ecosystem done by Rovex. So the whole ecosystem, they transformed a product model into a product and services model. Not only did they create a new revenue stream, they created a customer lock-in which was unique in its space, and it also, went on to customers, their competitors' equipment, which increases the scope of their service footprint. Second is Caesars Entertainment, a world-class gaming company, gaming and experience company, located 50 sites across the world. So they would collect customer data. They would collect a huge amount of transactional data and had a very well-defined loyalty program, which led to discounted stays, meals, and so on and so forth. But their challenge was to architect the data in a constructive fashion, to apply the analytics to create unique experiences of the customer. So what they did over time, they kind of collected transactional, gameplay, and demographic data and created a detailed profile of an individual. So they created a segment of one or a persona of an individual depending upon the transactions and the experiences that that individual valued. This led Caesars marketeers to actually sell curated services to them, that was one, and also the hospitality staff used the same data to kind of give very different experiences to individual customers, from check-in to room size to meal preferences and so on and so forth. So one could argue that this kind of a personalization happens in the hospitality industries for high-end clients. Now, well, that is true, but what Caesars' data-first model or analytics-first model did was to enable to do personalization at scale thereby creating a unique differentiator for itself in its sector and for its clients. So to summarize it, friends, it is about being very clear what is digital and what is not. Digital is holistic, therefore either you change or transform the way in which you create new alternative revenue streams or you engage the customer differentially. Hope you like the video, and we will be coming up with a lot more content, so stay tuned. If you like the content that has been shared in this video and helped you understand digital better, please subscribe to our channel and share as you deem appropriate. Thank you, till we meet.